Okay, so today I'm going to discuss the application of the BV quantization to string field theory. And I'll assume that you remember all that I did in string field theory. I mean, if you don't, then I'll not remind everything, but whatever you need, maybe I'll just mention. Okay. So let me just introduce some notations, okay, which is probably slightly different from what we had used earlier. Okay. So we'll denote by HT the Hilbert space of first quantized string. But it's a somewhat restricted Hilbert space, it satisfies the following condition that V0 minus on S 0, L0 minus on S 0 if S 0 is 0. Because it's a subspace of the full Hilbert space of states, and this is the space you work with all through the discussion on string theory. Now, we'll further define subspaces of HT. So in heterotic, we'll denote by HN a subspace of HT with feature number N. And in type 2, because you have both left and right moving picture numbers, HMN will be subspace of HT with picture number. Okay, but this is the picture number in left moving sector, this is the picture number in the right moving sector. Okay, then we introduce other subspaces. So heterotic, we'll denote by H hat the subspace H minus 1 plus H minus half. Okay, so this is in the Lebesgue sector, this is in the Ramon sector. And H tilde as H minus 1 plus H minus 3 half. On the other hand, for type 2, we denote H hat to be H minus 1 minus 1 plus H minus half minus 1. It sums. Okay, so these are the two subspaces we introduced. We divided into H hat and H tilde. Okay, the string field, as you saw, takes value both in H tilde and H hat and H tilde, but the one in H hat is the interacting field, the one in H tilde is the non-interacting field. I'll remind you in a few minutes. Then you also introduce a notion G, which is for heterotic, that we again divide. So here G is identity on NS and chi 0 on Ramon. Okay. What is chi 0? This is the 0 mode of the picture training operator. And in type 2, G was identity on NS. This was chi 0 on in is R, I0 bar, and R in is, and I0, I0 bar, R.
Both each
hat
and each field has h minus 1
minus
1.
Which one?
Both each
hat
and
h. Yeah. So the one in the Nevel-Swart sector is common. Okay. So this doubling, in fact, we have discussed, is not necessary for Nevel-Swart sector, but he just introduced it for symmetry reason. So indeed, both h hat and h field have h minus 1 minus 1. Just like here, both h hat and h field have h minus 1. Okay. So the Nevel-Swart sector stress always take value h minus 1, whether they are in psi or psi tilde. And correspondingly, the operator G is trivial in the NS sector. Okay? It is an identity operator. Otherwise, G is supposed to take from H tilde to H hat. Okay. Now, Grassmannality, okay, of basis states. Okay, and these could be, it doesn't matter whether it's H hat or H tilde. In fact, these are the basis states of H tilde, let me write it. Here it doesn't really make any difference. So this one is even for all for whose number even. So the Grassmannality is correlated with the Ghost number of the state. Okay. But this is true in NS of heterotic and NS NS and RR of type 2. And you have opposite correlation. R of heterotic and NSR, R in S of type 2. Okay. So the simplest example, or simplest way to understand this is, let's take host number 2. Okay, host number 2 is the physical sector, the matter fields of the second quantum. It will be the matter field of the second quantized theory. So if you take a ghost number 2, where the usual vortex operators belong, then what this is saying is that in the Nevel-Swart sector, okay, ghost number 2 means that the ghost number is even. So this is saying that in the Nevel-Swart sector, the basis states are even. Or in SNS and RR sector, the basis states are even. Whereas in the Ramon sector, or NSR or RNS sector, the basis states are Grassmann odd. Right, which is correlated with the fact that the Ramon sector should obey formulation statistics and the NS sector should obey bosonic statistics. Okay. For other host numbers, these correlations get changed, okay, and that has to do with the fact that the other host numbers represent hosts, right, so which have the same spin even if they belong to the NS sector. Right, their statistics changes because they represent the host rings. Now we introduce basis states. Okay, so we'll take the basis states phi r belonging to h hat and phi r c belonging to h tilde. And these are in fact conjugates. Okay, they are conjugates in the sense that if you look at the inner product, then the states in H hat are naturally having have non-zero inner product in the states in H tilde, because the total picture number has to add up to minus 2. Right? So just look at the heterotic. These two are paired under inner product, and these two are paired under inner product, because the total picture number adds up to minus 2. Okay? So these will be reflected here now. So we'll use a normalization. So this C0 minus is necessary in the inner product because both of these by definition are added by B0 minus. Right? Because the fact that they belong to HR and HT, I mean they are subspaces of HT, right? And those are all added by B0 minus. So to get a non-zero inner product, you have to insert inside a C0 minus. Okay, so you normalize the phi's, these are conjugate in this sense, that this is delta RS, and this in fact follows from this. Okay, you can easily check. You take the BPC conjugate and you have to keep track of the signs appropriately, and you'll find that this is the things to understand. Okay, now I'll write the completeness relation also. Completeness.
What will we see if I are
pardon? Phi RC typically will be, it's non-zero in the H minus 1, but in this it will be 0, right? Because phi RC belongs to H minus 3. Okay, so from this you can also write down the completeness. So phi RC C0 minus, this is identity. Okay, so this one, when it acts on H hat, this is in H tilde, right? So this has a natural inner product with states in H hat, and it generates a states in H hat, right? And you can easily check that this is identity just by using this relation. Okay, now I introduce string field. And here basically we use the convention that the field in the second quarter's formulation, okay, is like the wave function in the first quarter's formulation, right? Like you take the wave function in the first quarter's formulation and make it into a field. Okay. Wave function is the same as state in the first quantized formulation. So the fields in the second quantized form will be in one-to-one correspondence with the states of the first quantized theory. Okay. So a string field will have two components, psi and psi tilde. Psi will belong to H hat and psi tilde will belong to H tilde. So we can expand psi as sum over R psi R phi R, and psi tilde as sum over R psi tilde R phi R. Okay, we'll in fact later on we'll use a slightly different basis to expand in. Right now, I'm just illustrating this. And the point is that these have the same statistics, same grasp analytic or same statistics as phi r. And similarly, these have the same statistics as this is phi c. Okay. So psi r and psi tilde r are the dynamical variables of the string field theory, because these are encoding in information about the wave function. These are of course a complete fixed basis. Okay. And the point is that, so these, if this is Grassmann odd, this is Grassmann odd, and if this is Grassmann even, this is Grassmann even, and similarly here. Okay. That's what shows that the fields in the NS sector of heterotic are Grassmann even, okay, if the ghost number 2, okay, because the corresponding basis states have are Grassmann even. Okay. But this property means that the psi and psi tilde themselves, psi, psi tilde, are always Grassmann even. Okay, and this makes life easier to manipulate them. No, this is the assumption about our string field, right? Because we don't, I mean, well, it's what is, I mean, how general you want to be. You don't want Grassmann odd states in the NS sector, right? We know the NS sector should be bosonic states, and that's what this is imposing there. Okay, with this then, I'll write down the string field theory action, which again we wrote down earlier. So GS is the string coupling. I don't remember if I introduced the string coupling GS earlier, but if we introduce it here, so minus half psi tilde C naught minus QB G psi tilde plus psi tilde C naught minus QB psi plus sum over n 1 over n factorial. Yeah. This was the structure of the string field theory action that we had written now. So of these are of course self-explanatory. This is just a matrix element of the operator C naught minus QB G between psi tilde and psi tilde. This is the matrix element of C naught minus QB between psi tilde and psi. And this is the interaction term, okay, which receives contribution both from the tree level as well as the loop levels. Okay, so these I'll try to explain a little bit more, and I also describe some of the properties of this, which will be useful for us. So this object A1 to AN, what is this? This is the off-shell amplitude. Off-shell amplitude of external states A1 to AN. But this is not a full off-shell amplitude. Okay. This is the contribution by the event to the vortex. So if you recall, the whole idea of string field theory was the following, that we had the weak moduli space, okay, over which you have to integrate. For any given optional amplitude, you have to integrate over the whole moduli space. Okay. But what string field theory does is that it just divides up that moduli space into subspaces, okay, and the contribution from each subspace corresponds to contribution from a given Feynman diagram. Right? So you draw all possible Feynman diagrams for a given process, okay, and the string field theory, what it does is that it identifies each Feynman diagram with integral over some subspace of the moduli space. Okay? And the whole idea of consistency of string field theory is that when you add up all the Feynman diagrams, okay, you should generate integration over the full moduli space in a one-to-one fashion. Okay, and the boundary is the integrand should match up appropriately. Okay, so from that perspective, this is the contribution that we'll get just from this Feynman diagram. Okay, no propagator. Okay, because this is what appears directly in the action, right? The action contains the vortex directly. Okay, and now the idea is that if we now train this action, quantize it appropriately, okay, and draw all possible Feynman diagrams, then those Feynman diagrams will generate integrals over other regions of the moduli space, and together they give the full answer. Is this clear? Okay. So this one satisfies some important identities which I am going to write down. But before we write them down, I'll use a particular convention, okay, which is different from the one I wrote down last time, okay, where I had some sign factors. Okay. So the idea is that these in general, okay, can be Grassmann or Grassmann even. Right? The external states can be bosonic, fermionic, ghosts, right? So their Grassmann statistics is can be arbitrary. But to write down the various formula involving this, okay, it's much simpler if for every Grassmann or vortex operator, Grassmann or external state, we just multiply it by a Grassmann odd C number to make it Grassmann even. Okay. At the end, if we want just an identity involving the vortex operator, we just factor out the C numbers at the cost of picking up some signs, okay, and write down the relation purely in terms of the original vortex operators without the C numbers. Right? But once you put the C numbers in, the formula simplifies because many of the signs are there. So if you, what I'm going to write down now, if you compare with what we had earlier, okay, you will find that there are some signs which are not present in what I'll be writing down. Okay, but it's the same formula that we'll be writing down. Okay. The difference is that I'll assume now that all of these are Grassmann even. Okay. Even if they're coming from a Ramon sector state, okay, they are made Grassmann even simply by multiplying by Grassmann odd C number. Okay, this is just a formal trick to simplify the formula.
Suppose I have an amplitude I have, yes, a number of Grassmann even, b number of Grassmann odd sums, yes, so then by applying this method and the earlier method, if you equate, does it guarantee that only b odd c numbers will come out as Grassmann odd c numbers will come out as a solution and not? No, I didn't understand. Suppose you have b Grassmann odd numbers,
right? Grassmann odd vortex operators. You have to introduce b independent Grassmann odd c numbers, called as zeta1, zeta2, up to zeta b, right? And the equations will have will be multilinear, right? So from each term in the equation, you can factor out that zeta1, zeta2 to zeta b, right? You can keep it, take it completely on the left, right? But in the process of taking it to the left, you will pick up some signs, right? Those signs will be the additional signs that you will get, which will not be present in the form that I'll, in which I'll write the equation. Okay, otherwise it is the same equation that I will be writing. Okay, so I'll maybe mention a few differences that will become a bit clear. So the equation involves left hand side of the equation. Okay, So this will be the left hand side of the equation. Now, if you compare it with the left hand side that we had written earlier, we had a factor of minus 1 to the power sum of the Grassmann relatives of A1, A2 up to AI minus 1. Okay? And that in this language will appear because ultimately when you compare both sides, you will say you will take all the C numbers to the right hand side. Okay? And in the process of taking all the C numbers to the right hand side, those C numbers which are multiplying these will have to go through this QB. Right, and it will pick up appropriate minus sign, which will precisely provide us with the missing minus sign that we have. So the right hand side will there is something more to this, but I'll like it in a few minutes. Okay, but first let me explain this. Okay. So if you look back at your notes, the way we had written this equation is slightly different. Okay. We had here AI1 to AIL and then a square bracket of AJ1 to AJL. Okay, this is, so this sum is over all possible ways of dividing the set 1 to L into two parts. Okay, I1 to IL and J1 to J1 to JK. Okay. So earlier, as I said, we had a square bracket here. Okay. This is just a rewriting of that. Okay, you have the, if you take the square bracket, you can write this as phi r c naught minus on that square bracket. Then by using the completeness relation, you use the completeness relation, reinterpret this as the curly bracket from the definition. Okay, the definition of this curly bracket was something like this. Okay. And then you manipulate to get to this form. Okay, so you can, so I'll leave it as an exercise to check that what I have written down here is exactly what we had earlier in terms of the square bracket. Okay. Just by introducing a complete set of states and rewriting in terms of components. Okay, the other difference that we have here from the last time is that there is a sign factor. Okay, some sigma, okay, which was a sign that you pick up in rearranging A1 to N in this order AI1 to AIL, AJ1 to AJK. But all those sign factors are now gone because these are all taken to be Grassmann A, right, by introducing that Grassmann or C numbers with them. Okay, once you pull out those Grassmann or C numbers, this becomes exactly what we had in the earlier situation. Yes.
Just one question. I told you up to K, right? Zero square, right?
Sorry, I1, but yeah. So then IK, GL. Okay. Now, this is not a complete story, okay, but what I have described explicitly in the class was up to this point, and I'll explain the difference. So what I had explained explicitly in the class is the corresponding result for two cases. One is three-level amplitude, okay, the other one is 1 pi amplitude. Not this one, okay, not the elementary vortex, but for the 1 pi amplitude. Okay. This is the equation for elementary vortex, okay, not just at tree level, but to all loops, and that makes a difference, and I'll explain where the difference comes. But let's just recall where this identity had come, okay, in the analysis that we did in the class. Okay. So basically, what this identity represents is the following. That imagine that we have a vortex like this. We are inserting QB on each of the external legs and summing over them, right? Then we can deform the QB contour, okay, by the standard manipulation and pick up total derivative in the moduli space. Okay. So that total derivative will give boundary terms, okay, and the boundary terms will be the boundary of the region in the moduli space that this one represents. This is the integration over a subspace of the moduli space, right? So when you apply this QB one in time, you get a total derivative and it picks up contribution from the boundary of that region. Now the boundary of that region matches onto some other Feynman diagram, right? Because Feynman diagram shouldn't have the, once you add up all the Feynman diagrams, they should give the full moduli space. So this basically matches onto the boundary of a region like this. Let me try one more vortex here. So six. Yeah. So six. So this Feynman diagram, this propagator we replace by integral. So this is 1 over L0 plus in this propagator is what we replace by to the minus S L0 plus S from 0 to infinity. And S equal to 0 end of this integral, okay, is when this has collapsed, and that's what matches onto this one. So the fact that this, the boundary of this matches onto boundaries of Feynman diagrams like this is a reflection of this, that the right hand side should get contribution from these Feynman diagrams, but evaluated at S equal to 0, because you are only looking at a boundary contribution. And this sum basically means that there are not just one Feynman diagram, because if you mark them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, there is one where it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, but then of course you can have arbitrary permutations of them. Okay? And all of those will have to match up to some component of the boundary of this. Okay? So this is the case, this is the story, if these were representing tree-level vortex or 1pi vortex. But if there is genuine vortex of string field theory, there is another class of contributions, okay, whose boundary also must correspond to a boundary of this, and that's this graph. Consider there are six external lanes, x, this one. Okay, take a vortex with 8 external legs and consider a loop like this. This again, the propagator will have to be replaced by this, and when s becomes 0, right, that's the boundary of this Feynman diagram. Right, S equal to 0, and that has to match up with a boundary of the 6-point vortex. Okay? There is no other Feynman diagram whose boundary can match onto this. So this, if the boundary of this also has to match onto this. These diagrams are not present when you are considering either tree-level vortex, right? Because in tree-level, of course, you don't have loops. Okay? Or if there is a 1-pi vortex, when you build Feynman diagrams from 1-pi vortices, then you don't include loops. Right? But these will be there for elementary vortex like this. So that gives the next term. Let me write this now. S square by 2.
Coming from higher
GS. Yes, that you can see, because it's, there is a GS squared, right? And this reflects the fact that anytime you add a loop, right, you increase the genus by 1. And that's why these contributions get multiplied by GS squared.
In free theory, one can kind of normal order the interaction term to not have terms of interactions of this kind, right?
Yeah, but here, of course, there is no question of normal ordering, right? I mean, here, you have the full vortex. Everything is finite. Yeah, so there is a question of ignoring these terms, right? This is very much there in part, as part of the string filter refinement.
And if I normal order, the other piece, the normal ordering piece, which is this amplitude is finite, so therefore I cannot throw it away.
Yeah, I mean this is part of the amplitude. If you throw away anything, see the one in string filter, it's not that the vortex can be redefined, right? See, when you do normal ordering, that means you are absorbing something into some other vortex, but in string filter, the vortices cannot be changed, right? Because everything is finite, right, you have to include everything, right? If you throw away anything, then that basically destroys the consistency of the theory, right? So you have to include this, right? But these are finite diagrams, right? Even the S equal to 0 end actually is a finite contribution, right? It's somewhere in the interior of the modular space. So it gives a finite contribution, and that's what has to match onto some boundary of this. Okay, and this is what is reflected here. Right? You can see that you take the structure of this, you take two of these, phi r and phi s, which are these vortices, and glue them by this one. Right? This is basically the form of the propagator, but the s equal to 0 end of the propagator. Right? Otherwise, propagator would have had a 1 over L0 plus insertion. Right? But here, the s equal to 0 end doesn't have an L0 plus insertion. Right, because we are replacing this way to the minus s L0 plus and setting s equal to 0. Okay, so this is the key identity that you are going to use. Okay. And before I go on, there is one more word about the convention. I wrote down the action, I am going to erase this. Maybe I should have kept it, but it doesn't matter. Hopefully you have it in your notes. So this identity, okay, has been written in the convention where the weight factor in the path integral okay, you see, this is important because this is relating a loop contribution, right? So loop contribution depends on what the weight factor in the path integral is, right? Whether it's e to the s or e to the minus s or e to the is, that makes a difference, right? There are various factors of I, etc. in the loop, right? Now, you may ask, suppose I want to get e to the is over h bar, okay? What we had earlier, okay? How would this identity change, right? The simplest way is that because we have already that ds square in the s, you just say gs square to be whatever you like to get it to the is over h bar, right? If you say gs square equal to h bar over I, right, that will correspond to e to the is over h bar, right? So if you want e to the is, okay, just replace gs square by gs square by I everywhere, right? In all the formulas that we are writing, just replace gs square by I, that will give the result for the weight factor into the IS, yeah, right, to your minus S will be GS square goes to minus GS square, right? So just by changing the factor of GS square in the various formula, you can get whatever convention you want. Okay, are there any questions?
In first term, on the right hand side, has no GS factor. Right?
No, it has no GS factor because it's relating tree level to tree level, right? And the way I have introduced the GS square, it's the overall 1 over GS square multiplying the action. Okay, that's why it doesn't have any GS factor. Yeah? Because GS has been introduced so that it's like a loop counting parameter, right? As long as you don't introduce a loop, you don't get a factor of GS. Okay, so the goal now is to show that the action that we had here is already a solution to the master equation. Right? You don't have to do anything to make this, to quantize it. It's already is a BV master action. So all you have to do to quantize it, that is to introduce that pick an appropriate Lagrangian submanifold in an indicator. Unlike in the previous day, right, where we said that we start from some classical action, then we add terms to it so that it satisfies the master equation. Right? None of that is necessary. The action that we have is automatically the BV master action.
Because it has no residual
disinvariance,
that's why you are saying.
No, I'll show that it satisfies the master equation.
Okay.
But you have to introduce the fields and anti fields, right? You have introduced lots of fields, right? Many of which are unphysical, because the physical fields are in the host number 2 set, right? You have introduced all these additional fields of different host numbers, right? We'll show that they have interpretation in as the ghost of the edge fixing and the anti-fields, okay. But at the end, okay, that action doesn't have to be changed, okay. Just with a reinterpretation of what these fields are, okay, you automatically get a solution to the BV master equation.
And this also satisfies the boundary condition that if
you this will also satisfy the boundary condition in the sense that if you set the anti-fields to zero, right, the resulting action that you get is just a function of the physical fields, right? There is no dependence on the host fields.
Okay.
Right? So, and that you can reinterpret this as a classical
action.
Okay. Except that it will not be strictly the classical action, it will have GS dependent terms, right? Because there will be corrections from hard loops, and that basically reflects the fact that the classical measure that you are introducing, this integration over phi, is not gauge invariant. Right? So, effectively, you can say that you have to change the measure of integration, which is equivalent to just putting some, adding something to the action, right? So you interpret the classical action in the sense that it depends only on the classical fields and nothing else. Okay. But there are term corrections of order GS and higher order, okay, which if you want, you can reinterpret this as coming from a measure, and the action remaining the same. So you have to introduce, you have to divide the divide up the fields that we have into fields and anti-fields. Right? So far everything is a field, right? You have introduced psi and psi field. Now the idea is that we will interpret some components of those fields as fields and some other components as anti-fields. Okay? And roughly the way it will work, okay, is that the all the components of psi of ghost number 2 and less, okay, will be counted as fields. And all the components of host number 3 or more will be counted as antifields. Okay, but we have to of course say more, because I mean for every field there is a conjugate antifield, right? So we have to also say how they are paired. Okay, and that's what I'm going to do now. So some more definitions. H hat plus is a subspace of H hat of ghost number greater than or equal to 3, H hat minus is a subspace of H hat of ghost number less than or equal to 2, and similarly for H tilde. The basis states we'll take phi plus minus r, okay, these are the basis states of h hat plus minus. Okay, earlier you had used phi r as the basis state of h hat, right? Now you are dividing up into phi r plus and phi r minus, and similarly for phi c plus minus R will be the basis states of H tilde R plus minus. So orthonormality, okay, we'll choose as follows. So phi plus minus R C naught minus phi C minus plus S equal to delta R S, which is also, by the way, phi C minus plus S. So important point is the following. We already know that phi and phi c are paired, right? H and H tilde basis states are paired. But now we also use the fact that once you introduce C0 minus, plus is paired with minus. Okay, and the way to see this is that plus contains ghost number larger than or equal to 3. Right? Minus contains ghost number less than or equal to 2. Now a non-zero inner product will require that the sum of the ghost numbers to add up to 5. Right? It's 6, but there is already one ghost number supplied by C0 minus. Right? So the sum should be 5. And that clearly shows that if one of them belong to this, the other one has to belong here. Right? So plus and minus are paired. Okay, the basis states in H plus and H hat plus and H tilde minus are paired. Okay, and the basis states in H hat minus and H tilde plus are paired.
Like this separation that would have been done like starting from even 4 and 1. Like 4 and 1, then 1 up from 4 and 1 down from 1.
But then you have to also worry about 2 and 3, right? What to do with 2 and 3? Because we have states of all ghost number, right? So if you want to cover all states, right? So this is more or less the unique choice if you want to. Yeah. Well, you could have said that okay, you include 3 in H plus, okay, and 2 in H minus. Okay. But you could introduce 4 in H minus and 2 in H plus. You could have made a more complicated choice, right? But that's not what is useful for identifying the fields and activities. So similarly, there is a completeness. So let me write that down also. Is sum over R phi R minus phi C plus R C naught minus plus sum over R phi R plus phi C R minus C naught minus. This is identity on a chart. And if we replace, if we change C and not C, that means phi C minus R, phi plus R, C minus plus C R, phi C plus R, phi minus R, C not minus, this is identity. Okay, it's just a rewriting of the previous completeness relation, but now as a sum over plus and minus basis states. Because together they form the complete original basis for here for phi R and phi C R.
Minus has the effect of
changing entropy to field like that?
No, see, C0 minus is necessary just to make sure that the net product is non-zero, because both of these are analyzed by B0 minus, right? So, in order to get a non-zero net product, you need a C0 minus, okay?
No, I'm saying from the completeness relation, it looks like a zero.
Well, I have not introduced what fields and anti-fields are, right? We'll see. But yes, indeed, the fields will belong to, as I said, H minus sector, anti-fields will be in the H plus sector, right? And C0 minus will be at them. Okay, but you have to say more. Okay, because I mean the collection of fields is in H minus and the collection of anti-fields is in H plus, but which is paired with what, right? That you have to say, because otherwise anti-bracket is not defined. Okay, now we expand string fields. We give it a new expansion. Psi and psi tilde as follows. So for psi tilde, it's simpler. Psi tilde, I'll expand sum over r phi c minus r psi tilde r minus sum over r psi star r phi c plus. Now, notice the relative position of these two objects, that's important, because in general they may be grasp on odd, right? If they grasp on odd, then when you switch them, you pick a minus 7, right? So in this term, psi is on the right, okay? Here psi star is on the left, okay? You could have put it on the right, but then you have to pick some minus 1 to some grasp on it. The expansion of psi is a little more complicated, so we actually write this as psi minus half g psi tilde. So this is expanded as sum over r phi minus r psi r minus sum over r psi tilde star. So the expansion of psi, for example, will also involve these objects. Okay, now you may wonder why something like this. Okay, I mean the short answer is this is what works. Okay, this is what satisfies the BB. But I mean, if you want to get some insight as to where it's coming from, right? If you call this object, let's call this some psi bar. Right? Then you can show that the kinetic term for the action is just half psi bar UB. Not minus psi tilde. Sorry, no half. Okay, so it's psi bar and psi tilde appeared. So kinetic term can be written in this form. Okay, if you use a variable psi bar, but psi bar of course is not a very good thing for the interaction. Okay, because the interaction term, as you have seen, depends only on psi, right? So that's useful. So we don't want to write in terms of psi bar, but to get some insight as to why this is this combination is relevant, it's because of this.
See, if there had been a psi kinetic term, we would have been able to expand it just like psi tilde.
Yeah, if there is psi kinetic term, then you have to do something more, right? You have to again go back and see what assignment actually solves the mastery.
in the BP quantization general setup that you discussed last time, like we started with some fields and then introduced additional antifields, and that's how the some conditions were there on well that taken to zero goes to that. But here it seems like we have all these states, we are just dividing in them. I mean, we are not adding
exactly. So that's why the BP is a most natural framework for string field theory. That once you have written the string field theory action, it's already there. Yeah, you don't have to do anything more to the action. Right? You just have to identify what are fields and what are antifields. Yeah, that's why VP is the natural setup for string field theory. Okay, so now once you have defined it this way, right, you can define the anti bracket in the usual way. So for example, FG anti bracket will be, let's see, del light f del psi r del g del psi r star. But here, of course, you have two sets of fields and anti fields, del r f del psi field r. This is the expression for the anti bracket of F and G. Exactly what we wrote down, except that we have two sets of fields and two sets of anti fields. And similarly, delta F we can write down. I will not write down the details, but it will basically again have some of two terms, right? One is psi and one is psi delta.
Second part, is it del L of F with del R psi star? Or?
No, I think it's always the right with the left, because the idea is that the two derivatives will always sit next to each other. Right? So F is always taking derivative from the right and G from the left.
Yeah, but the second is not the inverted one in the bracket, is it?
This one. No, it's not inverted. It's, I think this is the definition of that.
Yeah, the derivative order didn't change.
Yeah, the derivative order didn't
change.
Only
size structure.
Yeah, only size structure.
Exactly.
Right?
Functions in the same order.
What?
Yes,
F and G order doesn't change because F is to the left of right, G in the left hand side. Right? So that order is maintained. Right? The left right derivative order doesn't change because they have to sit next to each other. Right? So that fixes that the first one should be on the left, second one will be on the first one will be on the right, second one will be on the left. What changes is that the psi star gets extended, or there is a minus sign. Okay, now the hard part, okay, which of course I am not going to do, I'll just leave as an exercise for you to verify. Okay, which is that if you calculate SS, okay, based on the formula for S that I gave, right, that of course is a function of size, right? So you can just expand it out in terms of psi r's, okay, take the derivative and put things together. Okay, you have to use completeness relation to manipulate the results. But this is given by minus 2 So the ordering is important because psi of course is even, okay? But this one, okay, can be Grassmann or not even, okay? So you may have to worry about the ordering.
So you wrote all the interaction in terms of this one PI interaction, these terms or this sort of terms?
Yeah, this one, even for one PI interaction, this would be there. See, here I am not using any property of the vortex. Right? So whether it's one PI or whether it's the vortex, SS will always be given by this.
No, that's why I am saying, yes, you did that, this sort of arrangement occurred there.
Well, testing gauge invariance. I think when I test gauge invariance of the one PI action, this sort of arrangement occurred. Yes. Because testing, the fact that it solves master equation is related to checking that the corresponding classical action satisfies gauge invariance, right? Okay, so SS is given by this, and the other exercise is to check that delta S is given by, oh, that is the factor of GS2. Let me put a GS to the 4 on this. Okay. Both of these terms have a minus 1 over GS2. Because S has 1 over GS square. Okay? So there is a 1 over GS to the 4. So delta S is minus 1 over 2 GS square. Delta S calculation in fact is simpler because the first you show that the kinetic terms will contribute to delta S, okay, and then the interaction term you just take two derivatives and put the appropriate terms. Okay. The important point is that you have to use completeness to sum over states and replace things by identity numbers.
So, first, is GS2 power 4 multiplied on the left hand side?
Yeah, because the point is S goes as 1 over GS square, right? So, when you calculate SS anti bracket, the 1 over GS to the 4 will always be there, right? That nothing is cancelling. And then finally, using the identity, okay, this is why we are using the identity. Otherwise, these are just, I have not used anything in deriving this except for the definitions. But using the identity, for this object, okay, one can show that half SS plus delta S
some GS
square. Pardon? No, here I think there is no GS square. Okay? Because SS has a 1 over GS to the 4. This has a 1 over GS square, right? But if you look at the identity had a GS square in terms of the second term, right? So this doesn't have a GS square. Okay. And this you may wonder that in the previous, last time we had a H bar, right? So where did that H bar go away? And the difference is that last time we were using the action. The weight factor is equal to the IS over H bar, right? Mm-hmm. Now you are using the weight factor is equal to the S. Okay? That's why you don't see any explicit GS in this. But if you put the explicit H bar, then we will recover the explicit H bar. So equal to the S, if you want to show that delta of equal to the S is 0, then you will basically get this. So this basically shows that the string field theory action is automatically a solution to the Bartan-Snell-Kowski master equation, right? And then that also tells us how to quantize it. You have to pick an appropriate Lagrangian submanifold and integrate by putting a delta function on the Lagrangian submanifold, right? You pick or you make a change of variables, introduce new variables, say chi and chi star, right? right, instead of psi and psi star, and then set the chi star to 0. So that's the last point I'll mention.
Was it expected that string feature reaction will automatically satisfy master equation? Just happens to.
No, it just happens to. So that's what this analysis shows, that one of course knew it from the bosonic string field theory, right? But there also it is unexpected why the string field theory reaction automatically satisfies master equation. Right? So what this whole thing shows that somehow the Bartholomew-Milkovich formalism is the most natural one in string field theory, right? And vice versa. That in for normal quantum field theory, right, to apply BV, you have to actually go through some procedure to construct a master action. Right? In string field theory, that is automatic. Whatever the natural action that you get by the procedure that we described is the Bartholomew-Milkovich master action.
So we look at the BV formalism, this antifields were opposite last time practically.
Yes, so that you can verify that this is true here also. Because
this is from the coupling, how you couple that, from that it should become.
Yeah, when you expand it, right? Psi multiplied certain phi, right? And psi star multiplied some other phi.
Phi r minus with psi r plus,
right? And the phi r plus and phi r minus, or phi r c plus and phi r minus, have opposite statistics, right? The simplest way to see it is they have opposite ghost number, right? Because their ghost number add up to 5. So if one is Grassmann odd, the other one has to be Grassmann even and vice versa, right? And the corresponding coefficients also have opposite Grassmann statistics. Right? So that's from that you can figure out that indeed psi r and psi r star have opposite Grassmann statistics, and similarly psi tilde r and psi tilde r star have opposite Grassmann statistics.
So
the final point. The next slide show that V0 plus psi is equal to 0 and V0 plus psi tilde equal to 0 is a Lagrangian summary. Let me be a little more specific as to what this means. So earlier, in the original definition of what are fields and what are antifields, right, I decomposed this into ghost number less than or equal to 2 and ghost number larger than or equal to 3. Right? Ghost number less than or equal to 2 were considered as fields, the ghost number larger than or equal to 3 were considered as antifields. But now suppose we take psi and psi tilde, okay, and divide it in a slightly different way. Okay. Those which are annotated by B0 plus and those which are annotated by C0 plus. See, you can always split the basis in such a way that half of the basis is annotated by B0 plus, half are annotated by C0 plus. Is that clear? See, suppose something is not annotated by B0 plus, right? Then C0 plus on that is not 0. Okay. So that's the second set of basis tests. Okay. So the basis test added by B0 plus and the basis test added by C0 plus. Okay. So if we split H hat into, now let's call it H hat 1 and plus H hat 2, okay, where this satisfies B0 plus H hat 1. 0 and this satisfies C0 plus H hat 2 equal to 0, and similarly H tilde into H tilde 1 plus H tilde 2. Okay, again B0 plus H tilde 1 equal to 0 and C0 plus H tilde 2 equal to 0. Then the inner product pair states with h hat 1 with states with h tilde 2. Right? Because if you take two states, both of which are another by B0 plus, they are inner product of B0. Because there is no C0 plus to be soaked up, right? So the inner product naturally pairs h hat 1 with h tilde 2 and h hat 2 with h tilde 1. So now the idea that you take psi and psi tilde and expand in a different basis. Okay. A basis of h tilde 1 and h tilde 2 for psi and the basis of h hat 1 and h hat 2 for psi tilde. Again, you use the same combination. Okay. And now you can show that if we identify the coefficients of the coefficients that appear as basis of h hat 1 as antifields, and the ones which appear as the basis of h hat 2 as these should be fields, okay, these should be fields, these should be antifields, okay. The h hat 2 and h tilde 2, okay, those coefficients to identify the antifields, these as fields. Then the first thing you can check is that this transformation, this is a linear transformation for the basis states, right? So this is a this transformation preserves the antibracket, right? Namely, if you define now this new size, right, psi prime r and psi tilde prime r and the corresponding antifields, okay, that this actually generates a canonical transformation. Okay, this is what you can show. So that means that now if you take the psi prime starts to 0, that's a Lagrangian submanifold by definition, right? Because you can make a canonical transformation and then take the psi prime start to 0. But if you now set psi prime start to 0, right, that means what? That you are taking the fields, the psi and psi tilde, to be h hat 1 and h tilde 1. Right? Those are annotated by B0 plus. Right? So that means that when we restrict the fields now to the subsector which are added by B0 plus, that's the Lagrangian submanifold.
Is there a natural way to see that this splitting?
Yes.
And putting that psi prime defined like this to 0?
Yes.
Is a smaller subset of the splitting that we were doing earlier, like verse number 2 and above?
No, it's not smaller subset. It's only half, you always eliminate half of them. Right? The problem was that in the earlier case, right, if you had eliminated that half, right, it doesn't fix the gauge. Because the resulting theory, okay, see, I mean, that's what we discussed last time also, that if we take the original action, right, setting all the fields, antifields to 0 is a Lagrangian submanifold, right, without making any canonical transformation. So what is the problem with that? The problem with that is that, I mean, that is ill-defined because you have infinity divided by infinity, right? But this one is not ill-defined, right? If once you make the B0 plus psi equal to 0, right, this you can show gives a
canonical.
Yeah, so it's a canonical transformation, and this gives a well-defined propagator. Okay, the kinetic term can be inverted, right? And you can carry out the usual string perturbation theory with this. Okay, and generate the standard perturbation theory that we had discussed earlier anyway. Right, this one word L0 plus as the propagator that came from B0 plus equal to 0 gauge. Right, but this analysis shows that that gauge choice actually is allowed because putting B0 plus psi equal to 0 and B0 plus psi tilde equal to 0 defines a Lagrangian submanifold. Right? So it's perfectly consistent with BV to use this gauge condition. Okay, I think that's about what I have to say.
So this Lagrangian submanifold is also not the canonical choice of Lagrangian submanifold.
Canonical meaning you can make other choices that will correspond to other gauge fixing.
Yeah. But this one is not of that form that fields goes to fields and the antifields goes to some antifield minus derivative.
No, it's not of that. It's not equal to psi star equal to del psi.
Right.
Del psi of some function.
Yeah.
Right? Because we are certainly mixing up the fields.
Yeah,
we are
mixing.
Exactly. So one could certainly try that kind of gauge fixing also for this case, yeah, it will just make life more complicated, right? It will not have simple interpretation as integration over one surfaces.
This is a usual single gauge.
This is the usual ceiling edge. Exactly.